Hello and welcome to Bloomberg Quint. Today I have with me the Joint MD and Group CFO of JSW Steel, Mr. Seshagiri Rao. Thank you so for joining us and congratulations on the number. After looking at the numbers, it seems like we've had a good quarter. Could you tell us like what could be the reason for that?
If you see year on year, I think there is a good volume growth. So there is a 43% growth in volume. But I think if somebody wants to understand the results, so to look at sequentially. Sequentially, the volume has fallen. Production came down by 5%, 3%, and the volume of sales have fallen by 5%. In spite of that, we could show a better performance in terms of EBITDA per ton. This is majorly some reasons which are some initiatives which the company has taken. Some of them are we have changed the product mix, we have changed the geographical mix. If you see in the Q2, our exports were 26% of the sales, so we brought it down to 21% of the sales in this quarter. Similarly, the south and west of India, if I see the Q2, our share was 80%, so we increased to 83%. Value-added products was 34% in the Q2, we increased to 37%. So what we have seen on account of either demonetization or not very strong demand in India, so we cut the low-yielding EBITDA products, we cut them and we increase our value-added products and change the geographical mix and bring some operational efficiencies. All this together, my EBITDA per ton has gone up to 7,711 rupees per ton, which is 21%. But again, what is very important to note is that in the Q2, my EBITDA margin is 22.2%, whereas in the Q3, it is 21%. So there is a fall of 1.2%, even the EBITDA per ton improved because of the change in the mix.
So you spoke about emphasis on sequential numbers. So can we see there was an impact of demonetization on your numbers?
I think this is very clear. If you see the Q2 versus Q3, there is a 5% fall in sales, which is equal to around 2 lakh tons. If these events have not happened, maybe our retail sales would not have got affected so much.
Okay.
So retail sales have fallen relative to the Q2. So whatever we have lost in the retail, that we could make up to some extent in the OEM market. But when we are not able to do complete complementing whatever we have lost in the retail market, then the low yielding EBITDA products we have cut it and reduced the production.
So you said like EBITDA per ton improved and it is due to the geographical mix. So Could you tell us like what is the difference there?
So that is the number which I gave to you. For instance, year on year, the south and west together, last year was 72%, in this year is 83%. Sequentially, if you see, 80% versus 83%. Similarly, value added products generally have a higher margin. Sequentially, if I look at 34% was my value added product mix in the Q2, which went up to 37%. Year on year, 36 versus 37. So I think the way we have changed either export sales reduction, value-added products increase, and geographically more sales in the south and west of India. This has given us an edge in improving the EBITDA margin in spite of increase in cost. Sequentially, my cost has gone up by 14% quarter on quarter, but in spite of that, my margins improved.
So you spoke about exports, and exports have like gone down. So are you facing any challenges in terms of exports?
When exports have come down, I think the way we have to look at what is that product I have not exported. We have not exported semis. We have not exported long, which we exported in the Q2. At that time, prices were quite okay, margins were okay. But when the coking coal prices went up quite substantially, which used to be $100, it went up to $300 plus. Scrap prices have not gone up. Generally, the long products are produced through scrap-based steel making. So their cost of production is lower. So long product prices have not gone up. So producing long product and selling at a loss doesn't make sense for a blast furnace maker. The coking coal price increase has to be taken by them. So that is the reason why we cut the production of long products and maximize the flat products and change the product mix, and we could make more money in this quarter per ton.
Alright, looking at the prices, the commodity market, in commodity markets, what is your estimate like going forward? Where do you see the prices?
Commodities are looking better, particularly after the events which we have seen in the Q3. And also the IMF projection in this year is 3.4%, that is a 3.1% global growth. This time the global growth is majorly driven, as per the IMF, is a recovery in the US and also a recovery in the Europe. So all this I think should give more investments coming in the infrastructure sector, and also oil and gas sector, metal sector, mining sector, these are the sectors where investments are likely to happen. That is positive for the commodities. Therefore, I think the slowdown which we have seen so far, or the low levels of commodity prices which we have seen so far, I think it is in the past. It is the past. Now it should look better going forward as per commodities.
So can you talk about the proposed deal between JSW and Bhushan Steel, or any other deal that we can talk about?
No, we don't comment on any specific target. Then as far as JSW Steel is concerned, our track record is whenever there is an opportunity, is inorganic or organic, we will do quickly and we will move fast. And we have the track record of turning around those companies and make them profitable. That is our track record. So our vision is to become a 40 million ton steel company in India. So we continue to evaluate if there is any opportunity that is available in the marketplace, either in India or overseas. There I leave it. I don't want to comment on any specific company.
So what is the current capacity?
We have 18 million ton.
Okay. And finally, sir, what are your expectations from the budget?
Budget, of course, general expectation is tax rates have to come down, corporate taxes particularly. Then the second area where we are seeing is more public expenditure by the government. Thereby investment cycle comes back, steel demand goes up.
Mm-hmm.
These are general expectations. As regards to specific to steel sector is concerned, the secondary steel which is coming into India, seconds particularly, the differential duty is not very high between primary and secondary. That is why some types of grade like electrical or tin plate steel, we are seeing an increase in the secondary grade steel imports into India. So we are requesting the government to increase the duty on the secondaries to 40%. Second is the imported raw material. The raw material if steel company has to import for its steel making, then the inputs are becoming expensive for steel companies. Any of the imports, like particularly coking coal, if you see the duty applicable is 2.5%, there is a 400 rupees cess. Coking coal is not available in India. Steel companies have no option except to import. So the duties are to be reduced to zero as far as coking coal is concerned. Earlier it used to be like that. Thermal coal there was a duty and coking coal there was exemption available. Now in the last two budgets it has come in. So we are requesting to make it zero and also to remove the cess on coking coal. Similarly, all other inputs like you take ferroalloys or electrodes or zinc or limestone, dolomite, these items duties are there today, so it should be made at zero.
Okay, thank you so much for talking to Bloomberg Quint.